You're tuned in to Nerd Overload, your weekly show for video games, movies, TV shows, comics, tech news, and more. Sponsored in part by Creative Foundations in Delaware and Starbase Columbus in Westerville. Now your hosts, Cody Pinnick, Samantha Cross, Sam Dunham, and Josh Harrison. Hey everyone, you're listening to Nerd Overload, the pop and geek culture show that you all love. It's time to make the donuts. I'm Sam.
I'm Josh.
I'm Samantha.
And I'm Cody.
Hey, thank you all for tuning in this week. We have a bunch of news and actually a ton of news to get through. But first, let's talk about some stuff we've been checking out.
I've started going back and rewatching The Venture Brothers.
Oh, very good job.
Always a good idea.
Yeah. Mostly because I couldn't remember where I left off. So I was like, I'll just go back to the beginning.
Which we should say is like a very sarcastic, satirical take on Johnny Quest. At least it was initially.
Originally. And Then they realized that Cartoon Network has the rights to Johnny Quest, so they actually threw in Johnny Quest characters.
Yeah, oh yeah, Race Bannon is in
and,
there.
And Johnny
That's
Quest.
That's right, Johnny's in there. Yeah,
he goes by Action Johnny because Warner Brothers wasn't sure if they wanted to make a
the
Johnny
first
Quest
time.
Movie or
That's
not.
That's right,
yeah.
But then they eventually just started calling him Mr. Quest. But yeah, he actually pops up a couple of times, and he is
and
like
Zen pops up a lot, just as Dr. Zen.
Oh, that's right. Yeah.
But it's kind of weird because like the first season was done like kind of in flash.
Oh yeah. It looks
it's kind rough. Of. It's a little rough.
Yeah. That pilot that they did with the ninja.
Oh yeah.
That one shot that was really rough back then.
It really was because like watching like. Seasons like 3 and beyond and stuff like that. It's like, man, I can't believe they got sick. The weird thing is, it's the longest running Adult Swim show still in production. They have 6 seasons and it's been out for 12 years.
They're allowed to do kind of whenever they feel like getting a bunch of shows done.
Yeah,
they do them.
Well, because the only like two, pretty much only two guys write it.
Yeah. It's Jackson Publick and Doc Hammer.
Man, I wish I had cool parents to give me good names.
Oh, they're nom de plume.
I know. I was trying to make a jokey joke.
And they also do like half the voices between the two of them.
Yeah, they really do.
They're very much Matt Stone and Trey Parker type dudes.
Very much.
But better.
Yeah.
But better in my opinion.
Well, it's different. They're both very different shows.
Yeah.
But no, I'd
say they're both very excellent at what they do.
Kind of opposites.
Yeah.
They crammed to do the show in a week, Matt and Trey. Public and Hammer take forever.
Yeah.
Well, they're allowed to take forever. That's the thing we're taking away is they're allowed to take forever.
It's so good that they're allowed to take forever. And it's supposed to be a special thing when it comes back.
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah. I mean, they are able to, because they take the time, there is not a bad episode of the series. I can't think of a single bad episode.
Yeah, they're all good.
Yeah, there's no filler. There's nothing.
Like, seriously, the one I just watched last night was the one where it's... I'm still in the first season. But they're looking for the saucer that crashed in the ocean.
And oh,
the
with Major Tom.
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I'd never really picked up on it when I was younger. But then I was like sitting there, I was like, oh man, it's all the lyrics.
A lot of Bowie references. There are a lot. Well, he's the leader of the Guild of Calamitous Intent at one point.
The leader is a shapeshifter who takes on the forms of Bowie.
Yeah.
Yeah. And that episode where they needed to get the panda, David Bowie's panda back from Roy Brisby.
Yeah.
The
Brizzy Bee guy.
Yeah. The Brizzy Bee. Yeah.
I watched that too.
That's a good one.
And it's a Molotov. Gets the bear back.
Yeah, we can't say your last name.
Nope. God, the show is so good.
It's one of my favorite TV shows of all time.
Mine too, for sure.
It was really funny because like I saw one of those like stupid memes about like, you know, the last TV show you watched is the character trying to save you or something. And I was like, oh good, I got Brock Sampson. I'm set.
Nice.
Like everybody is in the show is just a whip smart parody of some other cartoon character or superhero.
Oh, sure.
I still think Dr. Orpheus is like one of my favorite characters.
Oh, he is my favorite.
He is.
Yeah. I like Billy Quizboy and Pete White an awful lot.
Yeah, when they show up, they're pretty great.
And then they gave him their own arch enemy too in the last season. Well, not last season, but season before last.
Oh, they see it. I'm only through the first couple three seasons. I've seen some of season 4. I haven't gone straight through it yet.
It's Augustus St. Cloud, and he's like this rich guy that like collects like nerd memorabilia.
Like, so he's 21 or 23. Yeah. Which I can never remember which one of the henchmen is which.
In one episode, he gets in a trivia contest with Billy Quizboy and like threatens to make him eat a jar of pennies.
That's awesome.
Eat the pennies, Quizboy. And Pete White's like, just eat the pennies. I'm not eating pennies.
I'm also kind of sad that Stephen Colbert couldn't stay on to be the voice of Mr. Impossible.
Oh, I know. Yeah. That makes
beyond,
me
like,
sad.
Beyond, like, the first couple times.
Every time I think about it.
Professor Richard Impossible?
Yeah. Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah, I just got through that episode, too, where he has his think tank.
Oh, yeah.
Where you meet the rest of the Fantastic Four.
Yeah. Oh, man. That was rough.
Oh, the thing is just, like, a poor scab, like,
just scabbed over. Yeah. The Human Torch burns, but is not immune to his own fire, so he just lights on fire
and screams.
He just screams and runs around.
And yeah, he has to be kept in like a special tank, because as soon as he hits air, he catches on fire.
Yeah. That's actually kind of a callback to the original Human Torch, too, the robot from the World War II.
Yeah.
Yeah, he was supposed to be the world's first synthetic man, and something went wrong with his synthetic skin, and once he hit air, he burst into flames and became a superhero. Because that's all it took back then.
It's to be on fire.
Yeah. To be a robot that's also on fire, and that's it. You team up with an Aquaman with wings on his ankles and Captain America, and you're set.
You're good to go.
Good to go, yeah.
Oh, Namor. But yeah, I have been doing that, and I don't know, I've been playing a couple games here and there on Steam.
Mm.
Like, I tried out 8-Bit Armies, because there was a demo out for it. It's Command & Conquer, without the, you know, different factions having different vehicles and stuff.
Hmm.
Oh, it's kind of interesting. I mean, it plays just like Command & Conquer. Actually, more to the point, just like Command & Conquer Red Alert 2.
I never really got into the Command & Conquer series. It's probably something I should do.
I like real-time strategies.
I'm not a huge real-time strategy guy, but...
But they have like the first 5 campaign missions or whatever in it. Mm-hmm. So it was fun, little stupid 3D-ish 8-bit style art, chiptunes.
Cool. All right. Hey, I'm going to pause you right there for a second, Josh. Spit out your gum.
Oh, yeah.
This is going in the show, by the way. Get those lovely mouth sounds for the listener.
I'm sorry.
We're done. It's good.
I didn't realize that was
bad,
good.
Bad job.
Bad job. Okay.
But let's see here. What else have I been playing? I picked up this one game called Armello. It's like a board game.
It sounds like a candy.
I was going to say like a Carmelo. Yeah.
No, it's a board game that got made into a video game, but it's still a board game, but it's also like an RPG and a card game. It's kind of weird.
Huh.
Like,
and delicious.
I don't know. I've been having fun with it. You can play online against other people, or you can just play against the AI. Basically, from what I've been picking up, is basically Game of Thrones, but with animal people.
For furry. Game of Thrones for furry.
Shut up. But I don't know. There's a king who's king of the whole kingdom, but he's got a special magical disease or whatever that's driving him insane. And so the whole point of the game is to eventually become the king or queen.
Mm.
There's like 8 characters and 4 factions.
Okay.
And each character has their own special abilities, special things they get. It's turn-based. And there's like a day and night cycle, and things change between day and night.
Yeah, you can catch different Pokemon then.
Yeah.
There
only
is
time
that.
You can get Hoot Hoot.
Yeah,
at
I know.
Night.
I know, right? Except for in the day, sometimes he pops up, but he's asleep when you encounter him.
Ah.
Yeah.
Well, it makes it easy to catch him.
Yeah. Exactly. But Hoot Hoot sucks, so who cares? Anyway.
Oh, I like Hoot Hoot.
Aww.
He's not statistically viable.
Hey, you cannot take him to the VGC.
He's a middle of the road, stupid owl Pokemon.
I don't know. It was interesting and kind of a weird thing to pick up. And I've been playing a lot of Depth.
Oh, we've talked about that one.
Yep, I've been playing a lot of that, and I'm really bad at being a shark.
you're better at being a jet.
Huh?
It's a
West Side Story.
Oh, ha ha ha.
Yep, I was gonna say you're playing the game, just swimming along, and you just see the shark start snapping its finger, its flippers. Yeah.
I've been playing the crap out of the new Doom.
Yeah.
Ooh. And it is great. It's 100% awesome.
That's what I hear.
At least the campaign is. I haven't touched the multiplayer.
I didn't care for the multiplayer when I played it.
Except for the, I played the beta, but the campaign is so good. It's so Doom. Like, it's quick. The combat is super satisfying. There's demons everywhere. It's great. I haven't played a single player first-person shooter campaign that I like this much in a long time.
That's awesome. I've heard there's some tongue-in-cheek stuff, like Doom Guy doesn't talk.
Oh, yeah. Yeah,
he doesn't. And there's bits where they try to talk to him, and he just starts punching.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. He's super, like, there's something wrong with him. He's, like, super ticked at everything. He breaks everything. There's a little robot that you get gun upgrades from, mm-hmm. and instead of just taking the upgrade, he just punches the robot and takes it. Like, just for no reason, just because he's insane.
Yeah.
He's an insane, like, murder force of nature type guy, which makes sense considering what happens in Doom, the original game.
Yeah, I mean, it's Doom Guy. He's going to be crazy.
And there's some kind of plot going on where maybe he's not human, or he's some kind of ancient being that is awakened specifically just to murder demons.
Oh, wow.
Like, I'm not all the way through it, so I don't know. And I think I heard it doesn't 100% tell you what's going on with Doom Guy, but he's not a regular dude.
He's not right.
No.
The boy ain't right.
The glory kills are cool. When you shoot a demon enough times, it'll start flashing colors, and that's, you can run up and do a glory kill, which is like a super violent execution move.
Oh, wow. Oh man.
It's like a finisher, like a fatality kind of thing.
Oh, which is like two seconds of him twisting somebody's head around or ripping their skull in half
chainsawing them in half.
The chainsaw's a different item entirely. It's mapped to a button.
Okay.
Instead of having to switch to it and it being a weapon like in the original games,
mm-hmm.
you push a button, that's the chain, he pulls out the chainsaw. And it's just basically an insta-kill if you have enough fuel in it.
Oh, that's cool. I listened to a different review of it, and I heard that's kind of, you get more ammo back if you use the chainsaw. It's like a item management kind of tool.
Yeah. When you do a glory kill, you get health. When you do a chainsaw kill, you get ammo.
Oh, okay.
Huh.
And, yeah, balancing your glory kills to restore your health and your chainsaw kills to get ammo, it's really cool combat and makes you think about what you're doing. While you're also having this insane murder ballet around a room full of demons.
Monsters.
Yeah.
Oh, right on. I also heard the when you get the BFG, it is it's mapped to a different button too.
Yeah.
Okay.
I just got that in the campaign, and it's mapped to a different button, has its own separate ammo type.
It's almost like your grenades, almost kind of.
If it was a giant beam weapon that killed it, like it works exactly the same as it did in the original Doom.
Okay.
It's just the way the ammo works is a little different. And yeah, it's got its own button.
Gotcha. Hmm. Very cool.
It's basically when you're getting overwhelmed and there's too many monsters around, just hit that and it clears everything out. Suddenly you're in a hallway full of meat pieces.
Not even kidding.
Yeah.
Just like, it's like ham everywhere.
But it's amazing. It's one of the best games I've played in a long time, I think.
Oh, it's sounds a little bit like kind of like how the Space Marine game kind of worked a little bit.
I never played that.
Because when you did your really horrible, awful, special kills, you got health back because that was the only way to do it. And depending on the weapon you were wielding at the time, it gets bad.
Now, there's health pack pickups mm-hmm. in it too, along with the glory kills. And there's just regular power-ups, like a video game would have.
Oh, really?
Yeah, like, I haven't played a video game that just had that's just a power-up. Like, they're not like, oh, this is some sort of technological gadget that you have or you're getting. No, it's just a power-up. You pick it up on the map. Now your health's real full, or you can run faster. There's quad damage, like in Quake.
Oh, wow.
There's a Berserk one that lets you punch people to death. Like instant punch kills when you have this power, but lasts so many seconds.
Oh, geez. That's really cool. I only played I've only played the first Doom, and I dug it. If I've only played that one, would you recommend this one?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Honestly, the second Doom is the exact same as the first
Doom. Oh, it
Doom.
Is? Okay.
It's just got more bad guys.
Gotcha. Okay.
And Doom 3 is a weird...
I didn't care for Doom 3.
I liked it, but it's not really... doesn't feel like Doom to me.
Mm.
Whereas this new one feels like Doom.
Okay.
It's metal as hell. the monster designs are good too. They're different enough while still being callbacks to the original.
See, that's perfect.
Monsters. Yeah. I just wish the imps were furry.
Oh,
brown and furry, but they're not. They look kind of like the Doom 3 ones did.
Okay.
But the big old Kako demon, the big red floaty guy is in it. He looks cool.
Cool.
It's great. It's just great. I would fully recommend it.
Excellent.
The snap map thing looks cool, which is like it's a map making modding tool that comes with the game, even if you're on console.
Oh, really?
And
wow.
It basically feels like Doom Mario Maker. Like, you can drop in there and you can play levels people have made.
Oh, that's excellent.
I don't think anybody's really used it for anything really great yet. Somebody made a weird farming sim out of it.
That's awesome.
It's called Harvest Doom. But I really haven't played around with it that much because I've been stuck
murdering monsters.
Yeah, in that campaign, which is great.
Yeah.
Maybe you have a problem.
Because I've played a little bit of Tom Clancy's The Division, too.
Oh, okay.
Which I was sending you guys pictures of.
Yeah, you
of
were
that
sending
the
some pictures
day,
of that, yeah.
Where I made my character. And also, there was a cop's desk that had these big cartoon donuts on it that were totally out of place.
I was going to say, they looked like lard-lad donuts from The Simpsons.
Yeah.
They looked exactly like that, yeah. Actually.
It's a pretty good game. It's very much an Ubisoft game. They're all kind of the same.
Yeah.
But it's an MMO and, you know, cover-based shooter, which was shell shock coming from Doom and then going into a cover-based shooter.
Oh, right, yeah.
It makes me feel kind of weird to play it, though, because...
It's really realistic, kind of?
Yeah.
Or at least the themes are fairly real-world, kind of.
Yeah, and it kind of plays like a... I'm going to get a little political, so you're probably going to end up cutting this out, but it plays like a George Zimmerman wet dream.
Ah.
Like... It's the story is this like this plague hits New York and everybody's dying or not doing so great. And all the bad guys are like looters or people, breaking the law to survive. So you just go out and
anarchy.
Shoot these looters that are just trying to survive. And that's your that's your job.
That almost sounds like a precursor to Judge Doom or Judge Dredd.
Yeah.
Judge Doom.
And it
Judge
doesn't
Doom.
Help that like a lot of the looters. Daddy! Are black dudes with the hoodies up with snapback hats on. I mean, they're not all black guys, but it seems like the vast majority of them are.
Oh, that seems,
and it makes me feel icky.
That
to play.
Seems a little.
It was.
Not great.
It was. I don't think it was a great idea for a game concept, but the reward loop of playing the game is fun.
Okay.
Like, you get loot from the bad guys you shoot and
missions
and stuff. Yeah, the upgrade your character, and it's very MMO. Well, it is kind of an MMO.
Okay.
So it's a good game. It just kind of.
It's still kind of gross, though.
Yeah, it kind of rubs me the wrong way.
Yeah.
Icky times.
Yeah.
Yeah. Just go back to shooting horrible monsters of death.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, there's no problem with that.
Yeah. There's no moral hang. There's no, no moral hang ups. For shooting demons on Mars.
Even if you're an insane murder machine.
Yeah.
Last night we watched the movie Creep. It's a found footage film from 2014, I think.
Yeah. And normally I don't like found footage, but it worked for this movie.
I don't know. It still was kind of weird. Basically, this guy hires this guy to come film him for an entire day, pay him like $1,000.
Oh, I've heard of this movie.
Like, saying that, he's got cancer and he's dying.
Yeah, and he's doing it for, like, his wife or something.
Yeah, his unborn child, and things get weird.
Yeah, doesn't he dress like a wolf or something?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, okay, I've heard of this movie, yeah.
Mr. Peach Fuzz, yeah.
It's pretty upsetting.
Sounds like it.
It's super creepy.
Yeah,
I know all about it. It is super creepy.
There's just like a lot of jump scares, which I felt was pretty unnecessary.
Oh yeah, it's full.
I mean, none of it
was because it was unnecessary because it got you.
No, I didn't get me once. Jump scares don't get me a whole lot.
They got me constantly, but they get me back. I'm not good.
I mean,
with jump
this
scares.
Wasn't like out of nowhere one. So it's one where they build up the tension. You knew it was coming, so like it never.
Except for Cody.
Yeah, Cody. Oh God, it's easy to make him jump.
Oh yeah.
oh god.
But yeah, there's sometimes where like you knew one was coming and they would build it up forever, oh, and it was so painful. It's just like, oh no, like,
you were grabbing my leg. It's like, oh god.
Because I knew it was coming.
Because the guy's walking, because he basically has a camera on him at all times. He's just walking through this house, just like, it's like dark, and all through the house. It's like, oh, he's going to jump out. Oh, no.
It's also just a thing that the guy likes to do. He just likes to jump out and scare people.
Oh,
so he's
wow.
constantly doing that.
What a jerk.
But it's played by, was it Mark Duplass?
I don't know how to pronounce his last name.
I think it's Duplass. I think you got it.
Yeah.
We're going to say yes.
But you may have seen him on The League or... Well, was there something else? I can't remember.
There's a bunch of different stuff.
He's a known actor. I just don't know what he's in.
Yeah.
He nails it, though. He plays this creepy guy really well. And I thought it was all going to take place in this cabin, but after...
It took a turn.
Yeah.
Without spoiling
it. Yeah, I don't want to spoil it too much because it was pretty good. I it's worth the couple hours that it takes to watch it.
Okay, now is it Netflix? Is that where it's at?
Yeah.
Okay, cool.
There's just some shots that just give me chills still to think about them.
Yeah, it's shot pretty well for being found footage.
I usually hate found footage, it worked in this one, I think. It was a good part of the plot.
And it has some pretty funny parts, too. Like,
yeah.
It's hard to explain. Kind of dark funny. Just weird.
Yeah, sounds like it.
I don't know what else to say.
Okay.
You go.
It was creepy.
Yeah, it's pretty creepy.
All right, well, I just did one thing kind of quick this week. I rewatched Buckaroo Banzai Across the Eighth Dimension.
Never seen that.
You've never seen it? Oh, it's a weird one. I mean, it's funny. It's
weird on purpose.
Yeah, it's weird on purpose. It's written like an 8-year-old is telling you a story about their favorite character that they came up with, and it's telling you all these stories, and the story changes halfway through about 3 times. Nothing ever is like, it begins with Buckaroo Banzai, who is a neurosurgeon, physicist, super scientist, rock star.
With a band.
The Hong Kong Cavaliers, who are all super scientists that all play instruments.
Jeff Goldblum's in it.
Jeff Goldblum plays... Nevada, his newest recruit into the Hong Kong Cavaliers. He plays keyboard and is also a brain surgeon.
And a cowboy.
He wears a cowboy costume. Anyway, it begins with him testing out a new rocket car and ends with him fighting aliens to save the world from other aliens. Yeah. And somewhere in there, there's, let's see, Ellen Barkin is in there as, what's her name? Penny Pretty, who is the long lost twin sister of Buckaroo's dead wife, who is also a Scandinavian princess, Peggy Pretty. Yeah, and let's see. There is John Lithgow as Emilio Lizardo, who is a scientist from 1938 who got an alien trapped in his brain for like 50 years because they were testing the oscillation overthruster, which was a device that was supposed to let you pass through solid matter. But apparently, it also lets you go into the eighth dimension, where the black electrons, who are these alien, like these lizard-looking alien guys, have been trapped by the red electrons, who are the good guys, who are all Rastafarian. And they all, a handful of them, were able to escape in 1938, which was covered up. It was originally reported on as the War of the Worlds radio show from Orson Welles, but then was turned around and said, no, it was a hoax. But they were all brought in, and they all have the first name John, and their last names are all stupid, like Smallberries and Big Bootay, and it's spelled Big Booty. That one's Christopher Lloyd, by the way. John Big Bootay. Oh, yeah. Christopher Lloyd's in this. Did I mention that?
Yeah, they keep calling him Mr. Big Booty. Because it's Bootay!
It's Bootay! It's Bootay! No, have you noticed how frenetic this review is? It's because that's about how much this movie is. You are going along, and after about every 10 minutes, you go in a completely different direction over and over and over again. And it's written almost like a serial, where it's like an implied thing that there have been many, many Buckaroo Banzai stories before this, and there are going to be many, many Buckaroo Banzais after this. This is like just a story within the chronology of Buckaroo Banzai.
Kind of like the Indiana Jones movies.
Kind of, but nuts and very, very 80s.
And weird.
Oh, it's weird, but it's great. It's a great kids movie.
Wasn't Big Trouble in Little China is supposed to be a sequel.
It was original. The first draft of Big Trouble in Little China was supposed was written as the sequel to this, where it was Buckaroo Banzai versus the World Crime League. Yeah, there not much was left over, but James Hong was supposed to be Hanoi Chan, the leader of the World Crime League. But it's weird. Oh, did I mention Peter Weller is Buckaroo Banzai, RoboCop? RoboCop is Buckaroo Banzai. It's great.
It's such a weird movie.
It's so weird, and it's just all over the place. And the reason I watched it actually goes into a little bit of news we can talk about super, super, super quick. Kevin Smith says that he wants to, or has signed on to direct a TV series based on Buckaroo Banzai. And I don't like it. I don't think it's going to work.
It doesn't sound like his type of thing.
It really doesn't. There a while back, he had a script he was writing for a miniseries called Ranger Danger and the Danger Rangers. And it was supposed to be like a Buckaroo Banzai send-up kind of thing. And it sounds like he's just taking the script for that and just applying it to
the actual character. That's why Randall has a Ranger Danger shirt and Clerks, mm-hmm. too.
Yep, because it was a fictional show written within the Viewask universe. So it was like, it was almost like Fox Force or Femme Force 5 or Fox Force 5 or whatever from the Quentin Tarantino, where it's a movie or a TV series inside the show
inside
or what.
Paul. Well, I guess he's got his own universe too.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. So it's supposed to be that Machete was originally just a movie and then it became an actual movie. And
something kind of like that.
He's
yeah.
In Spy Kids.
Yeah. Machete's in Spy Kids. Like, no, that's Danny Trejo's character. He is Machete.
Yeah.
In Spy Kids. That's his character name and everything.
That's
it's
the
great.
That's the first time Machete ever showed up was mm-hmm. it was in Spy Kids.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. But
those movies are pretty, at least the first Spy Kids is a pretty good movie.
Spy Kids is it's a solid series. Mm. When they added Sylvester Stallone to the third one, that was kind of weird, where he played all the characters.
You mean Spy Kids 3 Game Over, the greatest film of all time? my favorite movie of all time?
Yeah. But anyway, Buckaroo Banzai, really good. It's on Netflix. Go check it out. It's funny and weird. But weird, but not like creepy weird. Just 80s frenetic campy weird.
We tried to watch it once and you made me shut it off. I think you weren't in the mood for Buckaroo Banzai.
Oh, you definitely have to be in a mood for Buckaroo Banzai, for sure. But yeah, that's all I have.
Might make a good I haven't seen that.
It would. It actually would make an excellent no, I haven't seen that.
If we ever do that podcast again.
We need to. We need to do that again. Let's go ahead and take a break here, and when we get back, we have some news.
Nerd Overload is sponsored in part by Creative Foundations.
Hi, my name is Robert.
Hi, my name is Amber.
Hi, my name is Jessica.
I'm Jimmy, and I work at Creative Foundations,
the store that employs people with developmental disabilities.
We have 4 locations.
Delaware, Mount Vernon, Marysville, and Urbana.
Our website is creativefoundations.org.
Find us on Facebook.
Set Phasers to Fun at the 8th Annual Out of This World Festival hosted by Starbase Columbus on May 21st from noon to 7 p.m. The Out of This World Festival will feature food, exhibits, a sci-fi collectibles auction, and more. Admission is free to the public, but donations are appreciated. Starbase Columbus and the Out of This World Festival is located at 5541 Westerville Road in Westerville. outofthisworldfest.blogspot.com for more information.
And we're back. That was Daft Punk's Harder, Better, Faster, Stronger, which we played because it's good. I've been on a real Daft Punk kick lately. I don't know why.
Yeah, it's just a good song.
They're a good band.
Yeah.
Oh, sure.
It's a great song. They're a great band. Check them out if you don't know Daft Punk. I mean,
they're crazy French robots.
Yeah.
You have no doubt at least heard one of their songs at some point in your life.
And Get Lucky blew up.
Was the hot new hot track of the summer about
it
2 years ago. Yeah.
And they did the soundtrack for Tron Legacy.
Yeah.
But we don't talk about that movie.
I like that movie. Am I the only person who likes that movie?
Yes. I can say.
I mean, I didn't hate it, but it wasn't. It should have been better than
I
it was.
I did not care for it.
I do think it should have been better. Anyway, yep. Speaking of nostalgia.
There was a new trailer for Ghostbusters.
Yeah, I didn't watch it. I haven't watched it yet.
Oh, there's a couple new things, but it's mostly a lot of the same scenes, just different parts of them.
Okay.
And it's put together better than the first one.
That's
was.
Good, at least. I just haven't been happy with the way they've been cutting their trailers lately. I don't know why. It's just not. The movie's going to be fine, but
I read somewhere somebody said no Paul Feig movie has a good trailer.
You know, now that I kind of think of it, the Heat, the trailer for the Heat wasn't super great.
No.
I mean, the movie was all right.
Oh, I liked the Heat a lot. That was a very good movie.
Did he do Identity Thief?
He might have.
I don't know. That had a real bad trailer, but I've heard it's really good.
Yeah. That one.
Who did that spy movie with?
Did he do it? I don't. I want to say he does every Melissa McCarthy movie for some reason.
Kinda. Yeah. Yeah, he did Spy.
That didn't have that great of a trailer.
That had
but
awful
it
trailers.
It's supposed to be really, really good. I've heard.
Bridesmaids.
Bridesmaids had an okay trailer.
I don't really remember the trailers for
I don't remember the trailer, but I love that movie. It was fantastic. Okay. Paul Feig just needs to hire the person that does trailers for Zack Snyder's movies.
You mean Zack Snyder.
He cuts his own trailers?
Yeah. He's Zack Snyder was a music video director. He cuts his own trailers.
Oh, well, he does a very good job of cutting trailers. I will give him that.
Yeah, oh,
and
sure.
An awful job at shooting movies.
Yeah. Well, no, I mean, he does a very good job shooting movies. He's just bad at writing and conveying any kind of emotion or some semblance of a coherent plot in his movies.
Because his movies look great. They're shot really well, and the cinematography is always has a bunch of cool moments. But
yeah, he should just not be allowed to write his own movies. That's all.
What if he's a robot or an alien?
That's why Watchmen was good, because he didn't write it.
He didn't write it. Yeah, he just copied
paste.
Yeah, copy-paste from the comic straight to the screen, and it was good. But yeah, Ghostbusters, I'm still excited for it. I think there are a lot of people that are not thrilled for it, and I just give it a chance. Just wait, see the movie, then form your opinion.
The guy that does Angry Video Game Nerd, he had a little public fit about it on YouTube about how he's not going to see it.
Yeah, well, your first problem is you watch something by the Angry Video Game Nerd.
Yeah.
Who is categorically the worst. Have you played his video game? It's terrible.
Well, I liked his video game,
actually. I hated it.
It's by the people that made the Manos game, which I love that.
Well, everyone's allowed to have one bad game. That guy could go...
Oh, I've always
take
not.
A short
he's
jump
always
off a log
rubbed
cliff.
Me the wrong way, and then like this video he did about Ghostbusters is like, I was right. He's a jerk.
Yeah. Although, how much of it is him being a jerk, and how much is it him
being a character,
being in character, and playing towards his core audience?
It's not. It's just him like sitting at a desk. Like,
oh, it was
he's
just
not
him?
In character. It's
oh,
just
it's
him,
just...
and he doesn't get like sexist or anything about it. He avoids a lot of the stupid arguments that. A lot of like
girls.
Misogynist jerks do, but he just throws a whiny baby fit for 6 minutes about how it's not Ghostbusters 3.
It's not that's dumb.
Yeah,
I mean I haven't hidden the fact that I didn't really think a Ghostbusters sequel. I didn't think it could have been. No matter who was doing it, who was starring in it, I didn't think it was
a good idea.
I've never shied away from that, but. I feel that this is probably one of the strongest ways for it to be done. If it had to be done, this is the best way for it.
Because there's money. There's a lot of money.
There's
there.
A lot of money. Sure, but but no, I've always said, you know, it's
why
does it really need to be done? But hey, whatever. I'm gonna give it a chance. Right,
and
what?
He goes
for sure.
He goes on this tirade about how it should be the original characters and they should be there. To hand it off to a new team.
No, like, because that would detract from the new team. You want it completely divorced
like,
from
you,
it.
I'm like, are you a baby? Do you need the old people there to pat you on the head and tell you it's going to be all right? It's like, no.
And for all we know, that could be there in some way, shape, or form. Because we don't know any of the plot of the movie. We know there's ghosts, and we know there's busters.
And it makes me feel good.
And I was thinking about it, and if they did a Ghostbusters 3 and it was real bad, that would do more damage to the franchise than a reboot would ever do.
Absolutely, yeah. Can you imagine trying to do a Ghostbusters movie with the actual original cast at this point?
It wouldn't happen.
No, because Bill Murray, he's surly and wouldn't...
He didn't want to do Ghostbusters 1.
Yeah, it wouldn't be good. Dan Aykroyd, I love him, but he's crazy. Harold Ramis has passed on.
Yeah.
And,
Ernie Hudson would be fine.
Ernie Hudson would be fine, but he's a jobber actor. He'll do whatever, but.
And they'll probably
screw. You cut me a check?
They'll screw him over in the plot anyway. So
because that's what they do.
Yeah.
Because he's not Eddie Murphy. Because he was originally supposed to be Eddie Murphy.
They're going to re-release the movie, and they took him off the box again.
What?
Yeah.
At least the one set just had the logo on it. And
This one has everybody but Winston, I guess.
Why?
Because that's what they do. They screw over Winston.
Yeah, I never understood that. At my folks' house, they have an old cardboard standee when the movie was originally being released. You guys have seen it.
Yeah.
You know, yeah. And no Ernie Hudson there. I'd never understood why. Is that the same kind of shot that they're doing for...
I think so. Really? I didn't actually look. I just saw a headline.
Wow.
Which is very internet of me to just read the headline.
Yeah. But then again, I guess on the same token, if they didn't have any production stills or any like production photographs of the four of them, it would be kind of difficult to put the four of them...
Although they did release it in 4K, they could have just took a screenshot and photoshopped it.
That's true. I think you got a point there. But no, I'm going to give it a chance.
Was the character Winston in New Girl, did they name him after Winston from Ghostbusters, you think?
They might have.
I think they did.
They might have.
It just dawned on me now. I'm like, oh my God, that's probably why they named him that.
You're having like a TV existential crisis.
Yeah. I think we've talked about as much about the new Ghostbusters as we probably
could. Yeah, we always have to hit it every time.
There isn't enough really new footage in it to really go, hey.
Yeah, exactly.
There was a lot more stuff with Kevin, with Chris Hemsworth's character.
Yeah.
Mm. I mean, he was pretty funny still.
That's cool. Let's move on to a little bit. You know, we were talking about TV stuff there for a hot minute, the New Girl and whatever. So there's a lot of cancellations and new shows coming out. So do we want to talk about that a little bit?
Sure. I'm mad because ABC canceled every show that I like.
I know, right?
Muppets are gone.
Yeah.
Gallivant is gone.
Agent Carter's gone.
Yeah, Agent Carter didn't even get a decent ending.
No. They cut it 2 episodes short, didn't they? Something like that.
There's like a cliffhanger.
Yeah, something
like
that.
And we'll never know.
Yeah.
Yeah, they did that bad. Castle.
Yeah. Oh, they got rid of Castle?
Castle got canceled.
Oh, you know what? Castle's been around for what? Almost 10 years at this point?
8 seasons, something like that.
But Nathan Fillion's out of a job.
Well, he's never out of a job.
Well, they were having issues because him and the main girl apparently hate each other.
Oh.
Ah, well, there you go. That would be difficult when they're love interests,
yep.
I suppose.
Yeah, they do not care for each other at all.
He seems like a nice guy, but I would imagine he would be a little difficult to work with at times. He just has that air to him, I think.
Maybe.
Just a little bit.
But Castle got a good run. The Muppets and Gallivant did not.
Muppets, they were in the process. They had a rough start, and they were in the process of course correcting.
And it was working. It was only getting better.
It was, but they just... Not enough time.
They really should have given him a second season, and I'll bet it would have been perfect.
Oh, sure. Absolutely. I agree with that. Gallivant.
I loved Gallivant.
I loved it, too, but it was a very niche kind of thing.
Yeah.
I could see them getting rid of that.
It was surprising that it got a second season, but there was pretty good online support to keep it around.
Oh, sure. I mean, Gallivant had a very small but dedicated core fan group. Same with Agent Carter. The second season was not as strong as the first season.
No.
But it was still good, but it just didn't draw the numbers.
I didn't watch it, so it's partly my fault, but I don't watch S.H.I.E.L.D. either.
And yet, Once Upon a Time is coming back next season.
Oh, Once Upon a Time always comes back.
It's never ending.
It won't die.
They don't make a special shampoo for Once Upon a Time.
You have to get a tiny comb.
It's such a piece of garbage. I hate it. I hate it. It's going to keep going, and they're going to really start like hitting the bottom of the barrel for Disney Fair.
Oh, yeah. Wait till
they haven't yet?
Wait till they bring in Toy Story.
Oh.
You joke, but I can see them doing it.
Yeah, that could be down the road.
There's going to be a cowboy man that was once a toy.
Yep.
That's how they would do it, too.
They
wouldn't be toys walking around. There'd be I used to be a toy, now I'm a man. Yeah.
And now I'm in love with one of the characters.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, and there'll be a car.
They'll cast...
Lightning McQueen.
All of a sudden, yeah, Emma Swan will get a real hot, sweet red car. But like the... But like the hood ornament, it's a little bent, a little bit, because Owen Wilson has a broken nose.
Oh, and it's gotta have the flippy lights for eyes.
They'll cast Kevin Nash as Ralph, a former construction worker. It would be Kevin Nash, not because he can act, but because he's as big as Wreck-It Ralph. He has arms and shoulders like Wreck-It Ralph. He is a living cartoon character.
Oh, wait till they go on vacation to Hawaii and, you know, run into Lilo and Stitch.
Yeah.
God.
They'll work aliens into it. I mean, why not?
Why not? Hey, I mean, it's a Disney film.
I used to be a fox. Now I'm Nick Wilde, the man.
I thought you were going to say I'm Robin.
Right, yeah. No, they already have
that's
Robin.
Right. That's
I've
right.
I've seen so much fan art of human Zootopia characters.
And that makes me upset.
It's dumb.
I mean, what's the point?
Yeah, come on. Come on, guys.
They could have Judy Hopps and because Jennifer Goodwin is on that show.
That's true. Yeah. Well, they'll just have an episode where she turns into a rabbit for a couple episodes.
Yeah.
That'll be your...
Or she starts being a cop.
Yeah, that's it.
She
kind of
is the show.
Well, no, she's the mayor now. I don't know if she still is. Last time I watched it, she was the mayor.
Well,
either way,
I haven't watched it in seasons.
Good shows got canceled, and
bad shows get to continue to live.
Well, let's switch over to Fox.
Yeah, speaking of good shows,
they released a whole bunch of trailers.
Speaking of terrible networks,
yeah, but they've released a whole bunch of trailers for their new shows for next season, and we're not going to go through every one of them. But we sat here and watched. I watched all of them earlier this week, but. We sat here and watched a couple of them, and there are a couple worth mentioning. Let's see. The first one is Son of Zorn.
Yeah, that looked really good.
Super great. It's like jerk He-Man comes to the like real world.
Yeah, it's done in live action and animation.
To meet up with his ex-wife and a strange son. Yeah. It looks really
It's going to get canceled.
I want to preface, none of these shows are going to last more than 6 episodes. I'll tell you that right now.
That's what Fox does.
Yeah, none of these, a lot of them look good, none of them are going to last.
If your name's not Seth MacFarlane, your show gets canceled.
Basically. although this has Lord and Miller attached to it. Son of Zorn.
A couple of them do.
A couple of them do, yeah. The other one, Making History, has Lord and Miller attached, and that's like time travel.
That looks really good.
Yeah. It looks really funny.
It's got a guy with a time traveling duffel bag.
Yeah, and he just goes back in time to the American Revolution
because he's got a sweet girlfriend.
Yeah.
There.
Yeah, and it's they barter everything with Ham. They smooth over every like problem with Ham and references to
movies,
2000s pop culture. Yeah. Yeah.
Lord and Miller are good at taking like a concept for a show that sounds dumb and making an actual like a really great show out of it.
Yeah. Some of the other shows that are coming out, there's The Mick, which is what if the nanny was a jerk?
What if the nanny was D from Always Sunny. And literally is played by Caitlin Olsen. Yeah. Yeah.
And it's like she's pretty much exactly the same character.
It might as well be a spinoff.
Yeah. What if it is?
That might be.
Man.
Yeah.
Because it is on FX.
No, it's on Fox.
No, but Always Sunny.
It's Always Sunny is on FX. You're right. Let's see. What were some of the other ones that we actually sat here and
Lethal
watched?
Weapon.
The Lethal Weapon. That looks good, but it looks like they're going to go with a dramedy kind of angle where it's going to be very serious at points.
And, you know, I know they always said that, you know, Mel Gibson's character in Lethal Weapon is insane.
Mm-hmm.
They turn the insanity kind of up to like 11 in this Lethal Weapon series.
I didn't think he looked insane enough.
He didn't look crazy enough.
He didn't look crazy, but he was doing crazy things.
Kinda.
But like Mel Gibson was like super nuts in Lethal Weapon.
Mel Gibson is super nuts.
Yeah, it was. I don't know why people were surprised when he turned out being, you know, actually nuts, because he plays a really good crazy guy.
Very convincing.
Lethal
Weapon. Yeah. Damon Wayans in this as the Glover role is really good. Looks good.
What was his character?
Murtaugh.
Yeah.
It looks good. I'm going to give it a shot.
Hey,
you think they'll
bring back the toilet joke from the one movie?
Oh, they've got to reference it. Oh, there's got to be a handful of references to the original movies for sure. But this is a new, it's not the same characters from the movie. It's the new, like, reboot kind of thing.
You can't drop the S-bomb on network TV.
No, that's
true. He's going to be too old for this poop.
Yeah.
I'm too old for this doo-doo.
I'm I'm too aged for this crap.
Yes. there were a couple that I watched that we didn't sit here. Nothing too great. There's a Prison Break. They're coming back with that.
Really?
Yeah. This time it's the other brother that is going to rescue the one that was in jail, that was doing the rescuing the first time.
Did he also get the map of the prison tattooed on his body?
It looks like it. Yeah, and it's funny watching it now that they've been on the Flash so often, because they're Heatwave and Captain Cold on the Flash.
Oh, yeah, those guys.
Yeah, those guys. So it's funny to watch them be goofy and just ridiculous on the Flash, because they're the best on
the
Flash.
They really are.
They're the best recurring villains on that show.
They're on Legends of Tomorrow.
They are. They're main characters on that, and then they're coming back for this and being super serious, and, oh, I have to get my brother out of Guatemalan jail.
Speaking of picking up new shows and canceling them, good on the CW for
picking
renewing
up Supergirl.
All of their shows. Mm-hmm. And picking up Supergirl.
And the fact that Supergirl is going to move to CW. Yes, please.
And it's 5 days of superhero shows. They're doing, it's like every day at 8 p.m. is going to be a different superhero show.
Here,
Arrow on Monday, Flash on Tuesday, Supergirl. Arrow's on Wednesday.
Supergirl would be on Monday.
Well, they released their new lineup for next season. It's like 8 p.m. Monday through Thursday, it's like Arrow, Flash, Supergirl, and Legends of Tomorrow, like 8 p.m. every day of the week.
That's awesome. It's cool that people will be able to find them at one set time. Is Eyes mm-hmm. on me in there?
It might be.
I don't know.
I didn't commit it to memory.
They probably don't consider it one of their superhero shows.
Probably not, but it's Eyes on me.
Oh,
yeah. I mean, it's a comic book show, but it's not a superhero show.
I would love the Flash to show up on iZombie.
Yeah.
Funny.
I mean, it's not really a thing that mm-hmm. would happen, but I would love it.
It would be pretty funny.
I mean, he could jump dimensions over to iZombie.
He could do anything at this point, yeah.
And he's a CSI guy. He would fit right in. It'd be great.
Really would. He'd be like, oh, you're a zombie? Okay, that's fine. I fought a gorilla once.
Yeah.
I mean,
and a shark man.
No problems. Some of the other shows, Shots Fired looks like generic cop drama.
Bleh.
The Exorcist looks kind of creepy, but at this point,
it can't really be that creepy.
It's a primetime television show.
On network TV.
It's not going to be creepy, but it does have Gina Davis in it, and that's pretty cool.
Yeah.
Star looks like what if Destiny's Child all grew up on the streets and then had a quick rise to fame, and there's internal conflict with the Beyonce character along with the other two. A lot. And
so it's that gem show?
Kinda, yeah. It's kind of like Nashville, but with girl group, and Queen Latifah is in it.
That's cool.
Yeah, so that's kind of neat. Pitch is about the first female baseball player in Major League Baseball as a pitcher, and it looks like just drama. Not really, like less baseball, more drama kind of thing.
Yeah, that could be a really fun show.
It could, but it's... It's not.
It's not gonna be.
It's not gonna be a League of Their Own.
Yeah.
Yeah.
See,
that's what I.
That's what I want.
Make a show of that. Make a League of Their Own show.
That would be really cool. But it's.
I've heard rumors in the past. They've talked about it, but nothing ever came out.
It would make a good continuing show.
It would. Like a period show kind
of.
Yeah.
You know, if Exorcist was like on AMC, then I would be excited
about it.
Yeah.
Let's see. APB is like if the OCP Omni Consumer Products. The people who created RoboCop, if instead of making RoboCop, they built an app and a supercar and like crazy future tasers and bought like one precinct of the New York City Police Department. it's like the super rich guy buys the police department and supplies them with all this super high tech
Iron Man
stuff.
Cops.
And APB is the app that, you know, the free app that all civilians can use and use to call in crimes.
It is not based on the video game APB.
No, it's not. But it looks interesting, but not. It's again not going to last.
Yeah, it sounds kind of. I don't know.
And finally, I don't know if this is a full show or if this is like a miniseries or what. But did you guys see the Rocky Horror Picture Show stuff?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I have a lot of opinions about that.
Well, this is a perfect place to air them.
It's just that I don't feel great about Laverne Cox playing Frankenfurter.
I don't either.
Because, like she can take whatever role she wants. It's not my place to say you should or shouldn't take this, but I'm about to.
Mm-hmm.
As a trans person that's in the spotlight, is it really a good idea to play a deviant sex weirdo on national television?
Yeah.
In this climate where everybody's throwing
protesting.
Fits about bathroom, who's in what bathroom, is it a good idea to kind of play into the stereotype that trans people are deviant sex weirdos when they're absolutely not.
Yeah, I don't.
Normal people.
Yeah.
It just doesn't look good.
And no, it doesn't look good either. I don't think it's a good idea to begin with. But that's what bothers me most about it, though, is like maybe as a role model for trans people like she is.
Maybe she doesn't want
to
be.
Yeah, that's true. Nobody told her that. That's why I said it's not my place to say that she shouldn't or should take this role, really. But it just, I don't like it.
I do feel like maybe Fox is, it's not a good time. Like the public climate's not good.
It's not the right time
to bring that show out.
I think Furter is a problematic character to begin
with.
Yeah, I don't know how they're going to get away with some of the stuff on television anyway.
I mean, I love Rocky Horror.
Oh,
it's
sure,
fantastic.
Yeah.
It's a great movie.
Definitely problematic.
Yeah.
Oh, and I guess Tim Curry is going to be in this as the psychoanalyst or whatever, the narrator, basically.
Yeah.
And that's cool. That's really cool. Plus, I didn't, I watched the trailer. I didn't realize Victoria Justice, the former Nickelodeon star, is
Janet?
Yeah, the normal gal.
Who's Brad?
Some dude.
Some white bread.
Yeah.
They should get the guy from Book of Mormon, not Josh Gad, the other guy.
The other guy, yeah.
Oh, something red. I don't know, doesn't matter.
I don't know, he was on The Simpsons a couple weeks ago. It was pretty funny.
Yeah. But no, it doesn't look good.
No.
It doesn't.
It didn't need to happen.
No, exactly. Yeah,
they still play it in movie theater, the original in movie theaters. It doesn't need to be updated
and,
or changed.
You know, a bunch of billion different groups do live action stage versions.
Yeah.
Near constantly. Yeah.
It's still very much in the public consciousness. You don't need to make a TV show.
Yeah.
I mean, I'll watch. I'll give it a chance. But I my hopes are not high.
No, same. Yeah, same here.
I'm not expecting a lot out of it.
Hey, we're getting close on time, but we got a couple of super, super quick hits here. There's a rumor that Blade, Ghost Rider, and Moon Knight are going to be Netflix Marvel series. Is that a good idea?
Yes. The more Marvel series on Netflix, the better.
Yes, please.
Yeah, and I think especially Blade and Moon Knight work best as miniseries. Ghost Rider, I'm not 100% sold on that, but it could go some interesting... It's just because the Marvel, the Netflix series have been more ground level. And once you add a skull face, flaming skull face man in there riding a flaming motorcycle.
Yeah, he's a little out there for the rest of their.
Yeah.
Ooh, maybe they'll make a Midnight Suns.
That would be kind of cool. The Vampire Hunter, like magic, evil magic man hunter show.
Yeah.
Yeah, that would be kind of neat.
It'd be just
get,
nice
like,
to see.
Get, you know, Benedict Cumberbatch on there.
Yeah, that would
Strange.
Never happen.
It'd be nice to see a Ghost Rider that's not Nick Cage.
Oh, what's wrong? You don't like half Elvis, Nick Cage?
Pee and Fire or whatever.
Oh,
the second one?
Yeah. See, Jeff Johns and John Berg are the new heads of the DC film department.
Yeah, they made a DC film department and they put these guys in charge of it.
Yep, and this is in direct correlation with the...
How bad versus Superman did.
How bad that did. And this is interesting because Jeff Johns, he's a comic writer, and he's previously been in charge of all of the DC television output.
We just went on about how good all that stuff was a minute ago.
So I think this is a good move, and rumor has it this might be what gets Zack Snyder out of the director's chair for Justice League.
Thank you.
They might... Please. Pull a 180 and try to course correct the DC movies. They need to.
Bye,
there's
Felicia.
A problem. Also, there might be a Harley Quinn standalone movie, which I love the character. I don't know if she can hold her own movie by herself.
I'll tell you that right now.
She holds her own comic book by herself.
That's true.
And it had two different concurring runs at the same time.
That's very true. Now, if they add Poison Ivy into
that would be how you do it.
All female cast.
Oh, that would be cool. That'd be very cool.
I just kind of want to see a Harley Quinn and like Poison Ivy kind of gal pal thing.
Gal pal? They're just pals.
I didn't mean like that.
I know.
I didn't mean like that. I mean like it's, I don't know, something where they're not being super, just being them.
That sounds boring.
I want
them to be super.
Yeah.
But like Gotham City Sirens, the movie.
That would be really cool. I would be into that. The last thing is, this is kind of a selfish thing for me. Have I told you guys about The Order? It's an independent film that's being made.
No,
I just
want to. About it at all.
Yeah. Well,
we didn't talk about it before we started recording. Please go ahead.
Okay. I just want to mention it because they're crowdfunding it. It's on Indiegogo, and it is a movie made up with the cast made up entirely with former Power Rangers, like
and Bulk.
Yeah,
and Zordon.
Zordon's in there. It was actually written by Zordon. David Fielding wrote it, but it's supposedly like a there's no superpowers. There's no Power Rangers. It was a group of clandestine, like super secret government assassins, kind of like the Expendables. Half of them go rogue and the other half have to bring them in. And it's basically all Power Rangers fighting each other in black leather and shooting guns and stuff. But it's starring, it has all the main ones. Austin St. John has David Yost, Walter Emmanuel Jones.
Is Walter Jones in it?
Walter Jones is in it.
Johnny Young Bosch,
Karen Allen. Is it Nikita Barres? Is that her name?
No, Amy Jo Johnson.
No.
Which is weird because she pretty much played that on Fringe.
Yeah. Let's see. There's a whole bunch. Nikita Barres, that she was the other Yellow Ranger. Catherine Sutherland, who was the second Pink Ranger. I can just name all down the line. Steve Cardenas is in it. Everybody's favorite. One person who's not in it is Jason David Frank, probably for a good reason.
No, friend of the show.
Friend of the show, Jason David Frank. Yeah, no, he is not included in this. He's like the one who's...
Because as soon as he was on it, it would be all about him.
It would become
him.
The Jason David Frank show. So there's a trailer online. There's an Indiegogo.
Honestly...
It's interesting enough.
It's probably best he's not there because of the fact that him and Austin St. John, they really don't care for each other very much.
No one really cares for Jason David Frank. He and David... David Yost, like...
Oh, no.
Do not mix.
Well, Jason David Frank has a writer in his contract for con appearances where he has to approve any other Power Rangers appearing at the same show he is at.
Yep, that's a real thing. So
do with that information what you will.
Exactly. Yeah. But yeah, keep an eye on the order. Go to any of their Facebook, like any of those actors' Facebooks or Twitters or whatever, because they've all been pushing it super, super hard. And it looks like it might have some Illuminati style stuff in it as well.
Especially with that symbol.
That logo. Yeah, for sure.
And it's not the video game, The Order.
No.
That came out not too long ago.
No. With the steampunk werewolf hunters?
Yeah.
It kind of makes searching for it kind
of
weird.
Yeah, that was kind of a bad idea to call it The Order.
It's a bad name. But anyway, let's go ahead and wrap it up here. You've been listening to Nerd Overload. Thank you very much for tuning in. You can find us each and every day over at nerdoverload.com.
You can also find us at Facebook at facebook.com/nerdoverload website.
You can email us with any questions or concerns at staff@nerdoverload.com.
You can tweet at us at @nerd_overload.
Yep. And remember, we are on iTunes and Stitcher. So, Ed, we'll take any likes or favorites or thumbs up or whatever
we can get.
We have a couple. We do have a couple. We have 10 five-star ratings, I noticed.
Nice.
Only 2 comments, but we have a handful of ratings.
One of those comments is really good. Somebody did a real good job.
Yeah,
writing that
someone
one.
Did an excellent job of that.
You can also find us on the radio every Saturday at 10 a.m. and 9 p.m. on WZMO 107.5. But also, we stream online if you're outside the listening area at WZMOFM.com.
Yep, go check that out. And, you know, they have a whole bunch of other really good programming over there, too. And I'm not just saying that because we kind of work for them a little bit. Kind of. Me more than any of you guys kind of work for them. But, no, they have some interesting... They play good music, and they have really good programming. So, yeah.
Hi, Tom.
Anyway, thanks for tuning in, and we will be back next week.
Peace out.
This show was sponsored in part by Creative Foundations and Starbase Columbus.